I'm really excited to be able to introduce Jim Hutchinson, a person who's devoted his career to applying green chemistry to his work in nanotechnology. And he, after getting a PhD at Stanford, has been a, is now the Loki Harrington Professor of Chemistry at the University of Oregon. And he's going to talk to us about applying principles of green chemistry to his, how you move the field of nanotechnology forward in a safer manner.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much, Pete and Karen, for the invitation to participate in the panel. We've heard a lot now about the application of green chemistry in our existing technologies and looking at replacements for our existing chemicals as well as design of new ones. What I want to talk about is how we can apply green chemistry to nanotechnology. And this is a really exciting opportunity because nanotechnology as an emerging technology gives us an opportunity to apply these principles at the very early stages. The stage where we can have, I think, the maximum impact. And really, I think, have the opportunity to get it right the first time. So really, this is just a snapshot of the kinds of things that are happening in green nanoscience. For those of you who have not followed nanotechnology closely, which is probably precious few of you, a really important aspect about nano, or one of the most important things in my mind, is the fact that nanotechnology provides this incredible opportunity to benefit the environment and human health through its practice. And I've just listed some of the various topics where nanotechnology promises to provide incredible benefit in cleaner production, in clean energy, in drinking water, clean drinking water for everyone around the world, for very high-performance energy storage, and for enhanced medical diagnostics and therapies. And one which is really rather simple and already pretty widely implemented, for example, in medicine, is, for example, catheters that have silver nanoparticles anchored to the surface, which slowly delivers silver ion in these applications, and in so doing prevents hospital-borne infection, which is one of our really important medical problems. Here, as another example, is a nanoparticle-based solar cell that's actually been printed on a plastic substrate. These are some of the benefits, of course, but what about the risks? And there's a quite incredible report that's been put out by Lloyd's of London thinking about and reporting on the risks of nanotechnology as it pertains to the insurance companies. And I think what I really like about this report is the executive summary summarizes the state of nanotechnology almost exactly as I would, so they saved me a lot of trouble. And the key points from their executive summary are that it's a huge market, and Lux Research, which is quoted in this report, has suggested that 15% of all products sold in the year 2014 will have nanotechnology within them. That's a key point. Nanoparticles, or free nanomaterials, have very different chemical properties than the bulk. There are unknown impacts on health, unknown impacts on the environment, and really many positive effects that might counteract the unknown or potentially detrimental impacts. And of course, really no regulation. And what regulation there is really depends upon our existing or current mechanisms. Well, what is existing right now? I'll give you here the material safety data sheet, which of course is not the best place to get your chemical knowledge, okay? But it is what is shipped with every chemical, and this one is particularly telling. This is an MSDS sheet for carbon nanotubes. And if you look here, they put the name carbon fullerene here in the chemical name, but the cast number is still the same as for graphite. It's called synthetic graphite up to 100%. It does acknowledge that there are metallic impurities within that material. And then if we start looking at the hazards, what we see are that these qualifying statements like no known hazards but, all right, that doesn't instill a lot of confidence in the application of our current regulatory system for this material. And then if anyone has worked with these materials, they'd recognize that these kinds of accidental release measures and personal protection measures are not at all acceptable. Okay, so, well, faced with something like this, of course, we should go out and study this. And of course, that's happened. And there have now been about 1,000 papers published on nanotoxicology. And the result of those 1,000 papers is that we still don't know a lot. We don't have any consensus about what it is about nanomaterials that may make them either hazardous or hazardless. So you can check this out in Environmental Science and Technology online if you wish. But the point here is that despite a lot of effort by a lot of people, we don't yet have any kind of consensus or guidance. And I'll come back to this. I'm going to leave this aside for a moment. I'll come back to this. In Oregon, what we've been doing is taking, I guess it's really a transdisciplinary approach. I like that term. A very widely interdisciplinary approach to try to address how do you bring green chemistry and nanotechnology together. And our aim, of course, is greener, safer materials and much more efficient manufacturing processes. I will touch only briefly on manufacturing today, but mostly on this topic. And how do we achieve the high performance that we desire without the unintended consequences that we want to avoid? It's a quite diverse team. There are about 30 senior researchers and about 50 students that are representing chemistry, biology, toxicology, physics, material science, and a variety of different engineering disciplines. So it's quite broad, and it's a partnership amongst the major research universities in Oregon, the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, and our sponsor, the Air Force Research Lab. It's been going on for about 3 years. And what we aim to do here is to really take more of a systems approach to this topic and really try to determine what the design rules might be for greener, safer nanomaterials. So if you think about a generic nanomaterial that looks something like this, you have immediately obvious a variety of different structural and compositional features that you can tune: the core, the shell, the surface coatings. How can we use those structural features to design and build structures that have the function we desire but without any, with minimized harm? How can we manufacture those very sophisticated materials in a way that's much more efficient than the discovery methods that are currently available? And finally, so many applications of nanotechnology are for green applications. Those should be made with greener methods. All right, so just one quick slide on manufacturing, because this is important. It is really the low-hanging fruit for this field. This is a place where there's been a lot done already. I'll show just two examples here from our own lab. In this case, what we've been doing is using commercially available membranes that have nanopores within them to actually separate the nanoparticles that we want to study from all the other small molecule junk that comes along in the synthesis. Nanoparticles are notoriously difficult to purify. This is one of the ways that we've been able to get really pure material that we can then study. So this is one area of manufacturing that has really improved. Turns out that this saves something like 15 liters of solvent per gram of nanoparticles in terms of purification as well. That's why it's in the manufacturing side. Over here, we've actually been exploring the use of very simple microreactors such as these, where you can mix very rapidly and then have material react as it goes through a capillary tube and then collect the material here. Turns out you can get incredibly high-performance syntheses in these small channel reactors that you can't really get in the batch reactions. So that's for another day. Bottom line is high-performance materials. So these materials are actually more pure and more well-defined. The procedures are safer, there's less waste, and this is cheaper. So it's a great benefit all around. So let's move back now to designing greener materials. You know, rightfully so, in the beginnings of nanotechnology, all the focus was placed on what we call pioneering applications. And over the last few years, there's been a recognition that along with the applications work, there must be some focus on implications. And what that's led to is toxicology studies primarily focused on what I'd refer to as near commercial materials. And you know, here's a variety of examples of different materials you can buy off the shelf. This is the kind of work that has led to those thousands of papers published in nanotoxicology. And one of the reasons why that doesn't work particularly well and hasn't yielded the kinds of concrete guidance that we want is that nanomaterials are really complex materials, often mixtures or ill-defined materials, and it's expected that their interactions with biological systems will be pretty complicated. And so that combination makes this a much more challenging task than taking a pure chemical out of a bottle and trying to study that. I'd notice one example, you can buy carbon nanotubes on the internet. You can just do that, go type it in, cheaptubes.com, you can buy that stuff. But they're cheap for a reason, cheaper for a reason. One of the reasons they're cheaper is because they have single-walled, double-walled, multi-walled carbon nanotubes. There is soot and there are metal particles. And I'm singling out that one supplier, but that can be said of essentially every single supplier. So that complexity makes it very difficult to study these materials. And there needs to be a bigger bridge that is brought between these two fields if we're going to address the many, many questions that arise in studying this. Right? One of the key things, as I mentioned before, is having the right interdisciplinary teams to study the materials. And the other one is learning how to measure these, the study of nanoscale metrology. How do we actually characterize these materials and track them in our test systems? And what that leads to, in my mind, is now thinking about how green chemistry can help even build an even bigger bridge. How do we, instead of saying just that we need communication here, but how do we integrate across this applications and implications gulf? And I think greener nano is the approach. What this says is that we're going to work together, bringing excellent materials chemistry together with excellent toxicology and bring those two together and take the information that we get and feed that back into design. That's what we're really talking about. So that ultimately we can reduce the hazard and therefore reduce risk. Just as a quick example of how we might do this, I want to make, first of all, clear that we don't start from zero, but we start from a fairly low level of understanding. A few things that we put forward in regard to design is, well, one of the things we might want to do is to avoid incorporation of toxic elements into these nanomaterials. Now, it's not always the case that a toxic element could get out of a bulk material, but these nanomaterials have very high surface area, and one might expect that the elements within them are going to be much more available than they might in a bulk material. All right, so that's one guiding rule so far. Another one is to think about dimensional bracketing. We do know a fair amount about molecular scale materials or molecular scale substances, and also about micron scale substances. So can we learn anything from those just in terms of dimensions? So as an example, if we think about soot and as being a larger analog of the carbon nanotubes, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons kind of look like carbon nanotubes on the smaller end of the scale. And so given that there are health risks associated with both of these extremes, is it likely that we're going to find carbon nanotubes not sharing some of those same hazards? Another example, in this case, two extremes where the materials are safe, microscale gold, which is biocompatible, or these anti-arthritic drugs that are made of gold, which are relatively benign. What does that mean about gold nanoparticles? This is the place where we can't just say, well, it's going to be safe, because there could be new properties that arise at the nanoscale. What our group is aiming to do is to study those and try to develop a design cycle that looks something like this. Take what we know about these nanomaterials, build precision engineered libraries of particles that systematically vary different structural components, and then put those into an integrated biological study panel, use that information to develop what the mechanistic knowledge of the bio-nano interactions, and then take that into design rules that we can cycle through again. So just to give you a sense of what's What we think is really critical here is you've got to have very highly engineered materials where they are pure, all right? So we care about elemental composition a great deal, the ligand to core ratio, that must be known. We look for small molecule contamination, and of course we look at the normal things you'd think about, which are the size of the materials. In the biology side, we take a look at a tiered approach, looking first to identify identifying endpoints that can help us understand which biological systems might be hit. So we use zebrafish, which allow us a rather high throughput approach to screening for these impacts. But at the same time, they're whole organism vertebrates. This has been very powerful so far. And once we've passed through this phase, we've started to look at cellular targets and distribution, and also looking at how the animals themselves may be degrading the material. And then finally, we've already begun some of the molecular expression studies to complement that. And a lot of this work is done in collaboration with Robert Tanguay's group at Oregon State University. So just to give you a sense of how we're trying to build up structure-activity relationships here, we want to ask some simple questions about how size of particle would matter and about how surface coating would matter, and developed a matrix where we've prepared, in this case, 12 different materials, all highly purified, and then studied those in the zebrafish model. And without going into the data here, since we don't have a lot of time, what I will say is the following, and that is to say that these neutral ligands seem to impart a pretty high degree of safety across all sizes, and we find that if we look across the sizes here, the 10 nanometer particles, the larger ones, seem to be safe throughout all surface coatings. I guess from the standpoint of mechanistic interest, this is the area to be focusing on. The cool thing for, I think, green chemistry is that we have a substantial amount of real estate to be looking at to find areas where we can identify materials that are non-toxic. All right, so just to summarize here, then, you know, the design rules as I explained them so far are, I think they're really needed for this emerging field, but they're currently pretty crude. If we're going to develop those, we absolutely are going to need to pay careful attention to what we're studying. It's fine and important to study the products that go out into commerce. It's a very important thing to do. But if we want to develop design rules, we really need to know what is in the sample. Collaboration and coordination are absolutely key to that success, and we need more of it. I showed here a couple of very quick examples of where surface coatings matter. We've seen this already. Size matters. And there seems to be an opportunity for designing for safety. All right, and with that, I'll thank a variety of students and postdocs in my lab, also our collaborators at Oregon State, and our primary sponsors for this work, the Air Force Research Laboratory and the Keck Foundation. And thank you very much for your attention.